Frenchie's Art Gallery, located on historic Oak Street beside the Maple Leaf Bar. With over 3,000 square feet of space, it features a large gallery front room and Frenchie's personal art studio. Frenchie's Art Gallery is also connected to the Maple Leaf Courtyard, which is ideal for the New Orleans night scene. Frenchie's Art Gallery, 8314 Oak Street. Yeah, you're right.
Well, here's the bottom line. Well, it's funny that you say that. Good evening, and welcome to Primetime Sports. Hey, I hope everybody out there had a very happy Easter. Hey, I'm still dressed up like an Easter bunny like I was last week. I'm going to keep this going all spring. I love it. Hey, next weekend, not this coming up weekend, but next weekend is one of our great weekends in New Orleans. Listen, obviously you have the great weather that's starting to hit here, but most importantly, you got the Jazz Fest, the Jazz and Heritage Festival. That's going to be huge for the next 2 weeks, and you have the Zurich Open, and this year, they have 7 of the top 10 golfers in the entire world are going to be right here in New Orleans. And I have Steve Worthy, the tournament director of the Zurich Classic, going to be here to talk about it. And also, the Saints have 2 picks in the first round of the NFL draft. That actually starts next weekend as well and goes through. I have a guy that's projected to be a 3rd or 4th rounder. Tanzel Smart from Tulane will be here as well. But talking about the Zurich, some of these guys they have, I'm blown away. Jordan Spieth, he won the Masters a couple years ago. He was considered the best golfer in the game. He's still considered top 3. He's going to be right here. Jason Day, who was number 1 for most of last season when he got on a roll winning 7 of 14 tournaments, he was going nuts. Ricky Fowler, who remember just 2 years ago, was in the top 5 in all 4 majors. That just never happens. And, of course, Justin Rose, who got to the playoff of the Masters this year, and a former Zurich winner himself, and 2-time Masters champion, Bubba Watson, who also won the Zurich, will be right here. So that's going to be a lot of fun. Hey, let's switch gears to baseball. LSU Tigers, hey, you know, they've been a little bit up and down this season. They took 2 out of 3 versus Ole Miss. They scored 15 runs in that first one. But the team that I've really been looking out for and been very impressed with lately is the Tulane Green Wave. Travis Jewett has done some amazing things. They started 3-12. Not a great way to start his career as Tulane's coach. But, man, they have gone 15-6. They just beat the undefeated UConn Huskies, who came in undefeated in the conference. And now Tulane, believe it or not, is in sole possession of first place. Hey, talk about some superlatives within the teams. How about Tulane's own Hunter Williams? He leads the American Athletic Conference in hits and doubles, 2nd in total bases, and 4th in batting average. And not to be outdone, the SEC's Taylor Schwanner, he leads the Southeastern's Taylor Swanner. He leads Southland Conference in home runs and RBIs, and he's 4th in the country in RBIs. Hey, UL Lafayette Raging Cajuns, they've got a lefty pitcher named Gunnar Leger, leads the Sun Belt Conference in ERA 0.95, plus he's a leader in wins and opponent batting average and 6th in strikeouts. And listen, LSU, we got the big bopper down there in Baton Rouge, Greg Dykeman, 2nd in the SEC in home runs, 12, and 2nd in RBI, 43. But the real big hitter is up there in Starkville, Mississippi. This guy, Brent Booker, I don't usually talk about Mississippi State, but he leads the SEC in home runs, 16, RBI, 61. That's 18 more than Dykeman at 2nd. And batting average, he's over 430. Steals, as well as total bases, hits, doubles, slugging average in the 900s, it's remarkable. 300 better than everybody else. The NBA playoffs started Saturday. It's truly the second season. It's going to last more than 2 months. Hey, LeBron and the Cavs, well, they started off, they've been slumping, and they lost game 1 to the lowly Pacers. But the series everybody wants to watch is OKC versus the Houston Rockets, or should I say, James Harden versus Russell Westbrook. It's going to be fabulous. And don't forget, Dede Bro and the gymnastics team, number 2 in the country. They finished behind Oklahoma for the 2nd straight year. Congrats. A great show. I've got Derek Freeman. Remember him from our band? And we got several other great guests coming up next right here on Primetime Sports. Stay tuned. We'll be right back. Welcome back, Crescent City, and the rest of Louisiana, of course, in the Gulf Coast and everywhere else that you're watching. Hey, I told you in the open that this is my favorite time of the year. The Masters just happened about a week and a half ago, and guess what? Next weekend, like I said earlier, you have Jazz Fest. You obviously have the NFL Draft. The Saints have two first-round picks, but my favorite event of the weekend is the Zurich Classic, and for the second straight year, well, I have the tournament director. His name's Steve Worthy. He's been in the golf business for 30 years, 12 years as directing golf tournaments, and six right here in his hometown of New Orleans. He's back again. Welcome back, Steve. How you doing, buddy?
Thanks for having me. Things are good.
I can't wait to get into this. Let's do it, because last time we got into your story, being a New Orleans native, LSU grad and all that, and then going out into the world and coming back. But now let's get into this tournament, because there's been a lot of changes, and I think it's pretty exciting. Why don't we get into this whole two-man team thing everybody's talking about?
Sure. Well, you know, every year at the end of the event, we look at what we can do to make things better. You know, we feel like we've had a very good event, but you want to differentiate yourself. Players have a lot of choices of places they can play. So in some of the brainstorming, we came up with the idea of playing a two-man team event. You know, the Ryder Cup, the President's Cup, very popular events. You know, guys, you only really get to see guys play on a team in those international events.
Right, right, right.
The PGA Tour has had a team event before. It's been since 1981. And however, in the history of the PGA Tour, they've never played alternate shot.
Wow, okay.
So this will be somewhat historic there. So our format will be two guys will play alternate shot on Thursday, and then best ball Friday, make the cut, then go alternate shot Saturday, and best ball again on Sunday.
The field is fabulous, and I think this is the best field since I've been back in New Orleans about 5 years. It's as good as it gets. I think you have seven of the top 10 in the entire PGA Tour. You have a bunch more of well-known names. But as far as how hard was it to talk guys into doing this new format?
Well, you know, when you take on something new, you're never sure exactly how it's going to be received. And frankly, while I expected good, it's been better than I expected.
Right.
You know, just because it breaks up the schedule, guys are playing individually every single week, and the idea they get to pick their own partner. So, you know, you got college teammates, old friends, so many different connections on how guys paired up. And I think they're just very excited to do something new and different. And, you know, they've always heard great things about, they love the city, they've heard great things about the tournament. A lot of guys that we haven't seen in a long time, and a lot of guys that we've never seen before. So the field's going to be good.
And they also do, like, I think I saw one of your top 10 players, Hideki Matsuyama.
Mm-hmm.
He's got a fellow countryman?
He does.
Do they do that as well?
They do. In certain cases, we've got two Japanese players. We've got two Canadian players. Actually, I think two teams of Canadian players. But in the case of Matsuyama, he's the fourth-ranked player in the world. And his partner, Hideto Tanahara, finished in the final four of the match play. So he had the 64. He bumped off Jordan Spieth in the match play.
Right.
And he got to the final four and almost beat Dustin Johnson. So a very good partner. We have got a lot of teams that could very easily win this thing.
Well, speaking of Jordan Spieth, I think that might be the marquee name. I mean, heck, he was number one. I mean, this guy won the Masters. He was second back to, you know, in between those other 2 years. He's one of the great golfers. What's it mean for you to have this guy in your tournament?
Well, it's huge for us. I mean, we had Jordan as a rookie. We had offered him an exemption before he was actually eligible to play. He played New Orleans and missed the cut by a shot and, you know, then blew up, and his schedule has been so tough. We've been trying to get back on it. And, you know, I think the team format was a big thing for him. He's been a huge success in Ryder Cup and President's Cup, and we are very, very happy to have him back.
I think we were the springboard. He's improved a little bit since he's been in New Orleans. It'd be nice to have him back. But I have to ask you about one of the teams that just jumps off the page at you. Jason Day, Ricky Fowler. I think there's going to be some big crowds following that pairing.
I'm sure there will. You know, Ricky is very popular. He's already won this year. Jason has a major to his credit and, you know, was world number one for quite some time. That will be a very, very popular group. You know, there are so many good ones. But, you know, in the way TV pairs, that group will have another very big name with them. So as you mentioned, I think you will see a lot of people following that.
Well, it's interesting to me because everybody was talking going into the Masters before the unfortunate injury of Dustin Johnson. But last year, the Dustin Johnson was Jason Day. I mean, how hot was he last year? And this is one of the premier young golfers we have in the game today.
Yeah, without a doubt. He had won something like 7 of 15 events, which is just
unheard of.
Tiger Woods-like.
Right, right.
And, you know, won the PGA Championship, got to world number one there very quickly. You know, he struggled this year some because his mom has had cancer, and he has really struggled with it personally. He did our media day here in a video conference, and you know, he's very candid about how it's affected him. But she did have surgery right after media day. Things have gone well, and he played Augusta and got better every day. And I would expect we'll see some good golf out of him.
All right, I have to ask you an honest question. You're sitting there watching the Masters. It's going into the last four. You know it's going either way. There's Sergio Garcia. There's Justin Rose. It looks like Justin Rose is going to win, and he misses a putt, and it's going back and forth. You have Justin Rose in this tournament. You have to have been rooting for him to win this.
Well,
if you're honest with yourself or with us.
Justin is a past champion here in New Orleans. He loves the city and loves the golf tournament. So I would be being dishonest if I were to say we weren't pulling for Justin. He's such a great guy. And you know, knowing he's going to be here, yes.
And for my English teacher will kill me for using this word, but it wouldn't have sucked to have the Masters champion coming into New Orleans. But you had the Masters runner-up, the guy that got to the final. He is certainly going to be in a great group with Henrik Stenson.
Absolutely. I mean, those two are good friends, have played a lot of Ryder Cup as partners. You know, Justin has got his own U.S. Open, and would have been nice to see him add the Masters. Would have been great. Henrik Stenson won the British Open, the reigning British Open champ. I mean, that's two top 10 players on one team. You know, I think they will be one of many teams that will be very tough to beat.
Well, I mean, I was going to say the two teams that I wrote down that did jump off, like I mentioned, Dave Fowler, and I put down Rose and Stenson because I'm like, come on, this is going to be formidable to say the least. But hey, you have two-time Masters champ and former Zurich Open champion Bubba Watson. He's always fun to watch.
True. You know, Bubba has had a lot of success in New Orleans. He's won here, and he always seems to play well here. J.B. Holmes, his partner, and again, a guy who was on the winning Ryder Cup team.
J.B. Holmes, nice.
You know, hits it a long way. Yeah. I mean, that's a group that will be fun to watch. They both hit it so far and are both great players. So, you know, another of the many good teams.
Now, I know there's like eight ways to pronounce Louis' name, but he always seems to come up big. Louis Oosthuizen?
Louis Oosthuizen.
Is that close enough? All right.
You got it. So.
He's always fun. Well, I followed him. I don't know what year it was. Maybe it was 2 years ago. He was doing real well in the tournament here, and I followed him. He's always fun.
He got considered to have one of the best swings on the tour. He and his partner, Brandon Grace, both from South Africa. Louis has a British Open, so he's a major winner. As a partnership, they went 4-0 in the last President's Cup. So, again, that's just one more team that a lot of people will be watching to win.
I mean, to have these British Open winners, Masters winners, this is a lot of cachet for the tournament. And then another top 10 guy, a lot of people might not know very well, because I think when you talk about household names, the avid golf fan would know him, but the guy that just watches the majors may just, but Justin Thomas is another great one.
Correct. I mean, started out, he's already won three times this year. I mean, that doesn't happen that often, and we're not halfway through the season yet.
I mean,
so, you know, really rolling. He's an Alabama grad, and he's pairing with Bud Cauley, another Alabama player. So we've got most of the SEC covered, and there'll be I'm sure some rooting interest out on the golf course among the SEC fans.
Well, you know, I'm be rooting for my man Smiley Kaufman, LSU grad. He is from Birmingham, but an LSU grad. What I love about your tournament, and listen, I haven't been to nearly as many as you, but I've been to several around the country. I'll put ours up with anybody's. I mean, honestly, hospitality-wise, the way you treat the actual fan that gets there, it's really nice. And I'm proud to be a New Orleanian when I come to this tournament.
Well, you know, we've always tried to cater to both the avid golf fan as well as those that aren't so avid. You know, there are a lot of things on the PGA Tour, a lot of different tournaments who have tried to copy some of the hospitality and food and beverage options that we have. So if you're coming out and golfing your first priority, you know, the Champions Club, the Acme Oyster House. So we've got, you know, 10
I've
or
been
12
to all those, by the way. They are fabulous. If you have a chance, do it the VIP style way. Champions Club, Acme, is both those are amazing. Anything else that people can get into?
Well, you know, for those people that just buy a grounds ticket, we have our absolute 19th hole.
Yes,
and
yes.
In most cases, you've got to pay a premium to go into a tent like that. You can go in that tent and you can buy food from Superior Grill and Superior Seafood. So we've got the gamut from the Champions Club all the way down to the grounds ticket.
Oh, the 19th hole is fabulous.
It is.
I mean, come on.
Bands play there on Saturday and Sunday night.
Yeah.
The food is great. It's air conditioned. You can get in out of the heat if that's an issue. And so it's a bargain.
I was pumped for the tournament before Steve Worthy came in. I am actually more pumped now. I can't wait to give you this gift certificate. You always seem to be helping us out. But here's a very nice gift certificate for a very nice restaurant, Chase Ellis. Check it out. Steve,
absolutely.
It's been fabulous, man. and I cannot wait to see you at the tournament. I'm usually good for a day. I usually go to the Jazz Fest too. But you signed my ball last time. He is an LSU guy, so he signed the Tiger ball. But I want to thank him again. Appreciate you, bud.
Absolutely. Thanks for having
me. Huge show today. Huge show. Kicked it off great with the golf tournament. But my next guest, by the way, he was a projected third or fourth rounder in the upcoming NFL draft. Hey, by the way, that starts 9 days from now. His name is Tanzel Smart, two-time all-conference player for Tulane in the American Athletic Conference. And he is coming up right here next on Primetime Sports. Welcome back to Primetime Sports. I told you we just had the golf section of the show, and now, well, we're getting to the NFL draft part. That's right, because I have a player that's projected to be in the third or fourth round. That's right, he is a two-time all-conference player from Tulane University, the Green Wave. He's from Scotlandville High School and one of the great players in our state, and I think he might be one of the good players you'll see in the NFL coming up in years. Tanzel Smart!
How you doing,
big,
man?
Big defensive lineman, about 6'1", about 300. You look a little less than 300 now.
Well,
you've been working hard during the getting ready for the draft, huh?
Yes, sir. I weighed in at the combine in the Senior Bowl at 296. So
296.
Yes, sir.
So you're getting just a couple cookies under 300 then.
Yeah.
So what position are you playing? Because I know when I watch you play, you got incredible feet, incredible hands. You move so well. What position are they projecting you to play in the NFL?
Mostly a three tech, you know, all the teams I talk to at the combine and the Senior Bowl really looks at me as a three tech, but you know, I could play whatever, 3-1-4.
All right, see, I follow football, so I know what you mean by three tech, but for the average fan out there that might be watching because of the golf guest, explain what three tech means.
So three tech is basically outside the guard, and it's basically like a one tech, but you know, the three tech is outside the guard and one tech is the inside shade. So you know, that's basically what a three technique is.
Well, I'm going to tell you something they will know. 200 tackles, 40 tackles for loss, 10 sacks. The guy can play some football. He had a great career at Tulane. And listen, last week I had Clinton Wenzel on. He was on the All-Dome team as a defensive lineman back in 1980-83. I think Tanzel Smart will be on the new Tulane Stadium Wave team. By the way, what was the transition? You played 1 year in that dome. And you were coming off the bench pretty much that year, but you were a three-year starter. You started all 3 years in the new stadium. What was the transition like for you? And I'm going to bring this up. Also, while you're talking about that, what do you think of the new Angry Wave? Because this is what I grew up with as a Tulane fan, and now it's kind of back. I don't know if it was ever a helmet, but I know I used to wear that in the shirt. What do you think about the stadium and the Wave?
Well, man, transitioning from my freshman year in the Superdome to the new stadium, it was wonderful because you know, the fans, like the first game, the Georgia Tech game.
I was there, baby.
It was amazing, man. It was amazing. And you know, I feel like if we would have had that stadium our freshman year, because I mean, we had a real good bowl season.
Yes, you did.
You know, it would have been even better.
Seven and five season. I know. I remember that. And that Georgia Tech game, you were leading in the game at three different times. But that, you know, what I remember about that? Two things. The parachute that came on before, you know, right before. They used to do that in the old Tulane Stadium with the Saints games years ago. But I also remember it was like 198 degrees. It was the hottest game I've ever been to. Do you remember it on the field?
I remember. It was real hot, real hot.
You're like, give me that dome back, please. All right, let's talk about this. You were at the Senior Bowl. That was huge because I think you showed out for the people. You know, I used to go to the Senior Bowl as an agent. And I used to help produce that thing years ago. And I know the amount of folks that are there just looking at your every move. What was your thought process going into it? Because you really impressed a lot of folks there.
My thought process going into it, man, it was just a blessing on being there and being picked to go there.
It is an honor. It's a big honor. Right.
But so my thought process was I have to go here and show them all, show everybody that I could compete with the top players. And, you know, I had an interview after that. They asked me. Yeah. They was like, so what is the difference between those guys and the guys in your conference? I was like, tell the truth, there's no difference at all.
Right.
You know, it feels like a regular Saturday.
Right, right. The same, you know, because your conference maybe doesn't get the credit as one of the Power Fives, but they got some great football being played in that conference. I just thought of something, though. Didn't you get maybe a little scrap in practice? Because you're such a nice guy. Is that I'm just dreaming this?
Yeah, I got a little scrap in practice, man.
Right.
You know, that's how it goes sometimes.
Sometimes it does. And by the way, also, you got the draft coming up. I mean, this is a big event. When you came out of Scotlandville and, you know, you went to Tulane, Did you honestly think that you're going to be in this position one day?
Well, you know, I set goals for myself. You know, I always spoke stuff into existence like my grandmother always told me, and I knew I was going to be in this position one day.
That's awesome. Hey, let me ask you this. As a player, when these guys talk to you at the Combine, that's another place you were at the NFL Combine, can you kind of have some fun with us and give us some of the questions that you were like, wow, I can't believe they asked that. Is there anything? Because sometimes you hear these off-the-wall questions. Did you get any of those?
Well, I remember one question. Well, two. One question a guy asked me. He was like, so what's your favorite movie? Right. And he was like, I know it doesn't have anything to do with football. I'm just asking your favorite movie.
You're like, is this a trick question?
Yeah.
Right.
And, you know, and the next one, a guy was like, so if you're in training camp, you know, we don't practice in pads. And a veteran was like, Young Buck, slow down. And are you going to slow down?
That's actually a very good question.
Yeah.
What is it?
And I was like, no, coach. I'm not going to slow
good
down.
Good answer, I think. By the way, Kenny Vaccaro didn't slow down either, much to the chagrin of Jimmy Graham when he was in the training camp and before that without the pads. Hey, by the way, I have to ask you the question. What is your favorite movie?
My favorite movie is a movie called Fat Beach. It was actually casted in 1994, I think.
Before you were born?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
What's Fat Beach about?
It's just fat guy, you know, who was either like a poet, and you know, it's a funny movie, and they go to the beach, he steals his dad's car, and you know, they have a fun time, like, got in a volleyball tournament to go to poetry class.
All right.
Yeah.
I think I need to rent that tonight. You got me interested. Hey, I have to ask you, a good friend of the show, Curtis Johnson, was your coach, obviously, for two of the years, correct?
Three of the years you were here.
And then you had a new coach this year, Willie Fritz. I like both the guys. Willie's been on a couple times. Curtis has been on the show a couple times. But give me the difference between Curtis and Willie.
Well, I guess the difference, let me see the difference. I mean, it's very hard because they're both nice guys. And so the difference between Coach Fritz and Coach Johnson is, I guess, like Coach Johnson came from a more NFL, you know, type of.
Sure, Saints, right?
Yeah, so he came from, like, he was like basically like the NFL type of guy. And,
right.
And Coach Fritz was kind of like, He wasn't like, because he never coached in the NFL, but it was real good because he, you know, he came from a lot of winning programs and his is like, I guess, not to say more family oriented, but like more, everything was like more like in, I guess, intact, you know?
Right. Yeah, college kind of atmosphere.
Yeah.
But the thing is, the reason I ask is because, you know, the thing you said, because, you know, obviously Coach Curtis had, Curtis Johnson had coached at Miami, but he had come for the last, 6 years or so.
Right.
Maybe he had been with the Saints, and obviously he got the Super Bowl ring. You know, I was curious, what was that like coming? You know, he'd already been there when you got there, but what was it like having a coach that had been in that situation?
Well, you know, he was very hard on us, and he was telling us, like, man, you can't do that in training camp. I'm trying to get you ready for training camp.
No, that's cool, yeah.
Yeah. So, but, like, stuff like that, just getting us ready for the NFL.
All right, when you talk to, when you just pretend I'm an NFL guy, what are you getting? What is this team? Let's just say it's the Saints, or whoever drafts you. What are they getting in Tanzel Smart? What kind of player, what kind of person are you going to be for that team?
So what I always tell people, you know, number one, you know, I'm God-fearing. I'm going to come to work every day with my head on straight. I'm going to give you 100% all the time. And I come to your team willing to, you know, get in the starting role, not to just sit back. I want to make an impact coming in.
So what do they say when you say that?
They're like, that's great. We love it.
All right, I have to ask you about another favorite of mine. You and Nico Marley, both all-conference players, both twice. The guy is like, 5 feet nothing?
Yeah.
And he has the heart of a lion. Tell me what it's like playing with him and your friendship with him.
Man, you know, we was very close, man. And, you know, we always, it's just, I know, say for instance, I screw up and I'm not in my wrong grip. I'm in the wrong grip. Nico's going to shoot through there and fly through there and make the play. So, you know, I always could depend on him and he could depend on me. I'm keeping the lineman off him and he's just making plays.
All right, I'm a general manager. Tell me why I should take Nico Marley.
It's a million reasons why I just take Nico Marley. I mean, he's going to be he's the smallest one on the field, but he's going to be the most impactful on the field. And, you know, he's smart, he's fast, he's strong. Just be that small, man. I think that somebody should grab him.
Well, I know half the NFL is watching this show. Wink, wink. But Take this man, Tanzel Smart. He's got his head on straight. And get yourself a little lunch. That is right by Tulane's campus on Maple between Carrollton and Broadway. And I am proud to get your signature along here with Mike Dunleavy, Troy Dannon, the AD, Willie Fritz, Travis Jewett, and Clint Wenzel. And we're going to add Tanzel Smart. Roll wave. Congratulations. I cannot wait to watch this young man get drafted and play in the NFL. Hey, coming up next, we're switching gears. We're going to have some music. Derek Freeman's coming up next. And after that, don't forget, I have Paul Atkinson. He is the producer, director of Glory Days, a trip through Newman Sees. He's done a lot of these documentaries. It's going to air on CST this weekend. He's going to be coming up as well. And we have a lot to come right here on Primetime Sports. Stay tuned.
Rock and roll will never die. It's old New Orleans, my, oh my. Come on, baby, let's go rock and roll at the City Lane. All night, let's roll, let's rock and roll. Baby, do the rock and roll at the City Lane, the home of rock and roll.
The owners of the Delachaise Wine Bar on St. Charles Avenue have opened up their newest creation uptown on Maple Street called Chez Delachaise, a new local wine bistro featuring a larger menu of small and large plates, a brighter atmosphere, and full table service. Additionally, patrons can enjoy a large patio out front as well as an extensive wine list offering selections from around the world. It's Chez Delachaise, 7708 Maple Street between Carrollton and Broadway.
Crescent City Steakhouse, a true neighborhood restaurant operated by the Vojkovich family since 1934, is the oldest steakhouse in the city of New Orleans. Serving only hand-cut, prime-age, corn-fed beef for over 80 years, Crescent City Steakhouse has become a dining destination for both diehard locals and adventurous travelers who seek traditional, timeless New Orleans cuisine. Crescent City Steakhouse, 1001 North Broad, on the corner of St. Philip, in the heart of New Orleans. That was a great treat by my man Derek Freeman, who's about to be my next guest. James Martin, you remember him? He's been a guest on the show, and he was part of the Martin Freeman Genius. And, of course, Corey was on the big brass right there. I think that's a tuba, right? Anyway, so, hey, I'm bringing back Derek Freeman, who was the leader of our band. Remember for the first 5 months or so when we were in the old studio, we had room for a band. And I've been missing these guys, so I wanted to bring him back, say hello, kind of let you know what he's doing for the Jazz Fest, and here he is, Derek Smoker Freeman. Welcome back, my man.
Scott, great to see you,
cousin.
Good
to see you, bro.
Yes, sir.
I saw you at one of the festivals at Armstrong Park recently, yeah. And I was in my mind, I'm thinking, I got to bring him back because Jazz Fest, it's not necessarily the people think, oh, you got to talk about what they do at Jazz Fest. It's not just Jazz Fest, it's what goes on around it. So I'm kind of going to give you the floor on what's happening with you for the next few weeks.
Oh, man, and the next few weeks are jam packed for us, fortunately. We got nominated for a Big Easy Award. I'm excited about that.
That's huge.
Sir, Monday.
Congrats.
For Best Brass Band, which is almost incredible when you think about it. And then Jazz Fest, we're playing April 28th, the first day of Jazz Fest, in the Lanyap stage. And also on the 29th, we're doing a show opening up for Wyclef Jean.
Wow.
At the House of Blues. That's a benefit for VH1 Save the Music.
Wow. All right.
Then Monday, May 1st, we're playing at the Blue Nile with our good friends Red Barat, which is like this Middle Eastern brass band from Brooklyn. So our first gig ever was actually with them. So it's like a full circle thing for us.
So this is the first soul brass band?
The first soul brass band
we
ever played.
By the way, here's the soul brass band we're talking about. They got some got some swag. I love it. I love when the guests bring swag.
Oh, yeah.
By the way, I remember when y'all were kind of getting that thing started, and now you guys are everywhere. And this is the band that's nominated for the offbeat?
Yeah. Yeah, it's
congrats,
incredible.
Congrats, man.
We won the offbeat award.
Yeah.
But now we're nominated for a Big Easy Award.
Wow.
Yeah, it's crazy.
I mean, isn't that huge?
Yeah, it's huge. And we're going to Europe for about 6 weeks this summer.
With the entire band?
The entire band. They all had like there's eight of us going.
Is James Martin going with
James
you?
Martin, of course. He's my right-hand man. I can't get nowhere. James and, of course, Aaron Lambert, who you know. Tuba Steve, who was MFG.
Tuba Fix. Steve. I love Tuba
Steve.
So,
yeah, the whole crew. Kevin Lewis, who you might have met.
Right.
And who else am I
missing? Did you say Aaron Lambert?
Aaron Lambert, of course.
Oh, nice, yeah. Nice. Yeah. Oh, he wore the Saints jersey when he subbed.
Oh, yeah.
The Deuce jersey. I love Aaron Lambert.
Yeah, of course. Yes.
Big Cavalier, too.
Brother from another mother.
We'll talk about that European tour. That's kind of fun. I mean, because you always go to Europe.
And
you're well known over there.
A lot of us are gone, you know, right. In different groups or like as individuals, but we get to travel with the whole band, man. It's going to be exciting. I mean, I just hope.
What are your favorite spots? Because there was one, and I'm trying to remember if it's in Switzerland or somewhere.
Is it Ascona, Switzerland?
Yeah, yeah.
Because that's going to be one of our first stops.
Because you're like Jimi Hendrix over there.
Oh, man.
I mean, you are. I mean, it's funny. I read the comments, and they're like, Gary Freeman's back.
It's awesome because it's like it's between the musicians and the soccer players, like who gets the most love on the piazza, you know what I mean? So we have a great time. We're also going to Copenhagen. We're doing a Fringe Jazz Festival there. And I'm going somewhere I've never been before, Edinburgh, Scotland.
Oh, wow.
I'm really looking forward to that. Yeah.
Because that's not on the beaten path right there.
No, man. It was a...
Now, how'd you pull that gig off?
I don't know. I have no idea.
I don't know. I love it. Oh, man.
But, I'm looking so forward to it. And then big things coming up. We got an album. We're probably going to put the album out in the fall. We're probably recording when we get back from Europe.
With this band?
With the band, yeah.
Now, tell me what other bands you still with, because I remember you had your hand in Smoker's World, Martin Freeman Genius, you had some solo stuff.
Yeah, Smoker's World kind of, it was always sort of a 90s cover band, but we kind of concentrated and made it more just like specifically hip-hop covers, and now it's called the Low End Theory Players. We started off doing Tribe Called Quest.
Right, Tribe Called Quest. That was a big tribute band.
But we're trying to get into. We're thinking about doing an Outkast tribute and an NWA tribute.
Nice.
So
did you do a Beastie Boys tribute or something?
Not me personally, but we're loosely affiliated. Like two of the rappers in the Low End Theory Players are also in the Sabotage, and they're also the two guys that I have my production company with, Dumb Smart Industries, or we make the little movies.
Well, how's the acting career going?
Man, it's going pretty good. I mean,
You've been to our studio, apparently.
Right.
I got fitted here. That's pretty funny.
When I was in Queen Sugar, shout out to Queen Sugar. But we've been doing our own stuff lately, making our own movies, and we're about to submit a bunch of them to the festival, so that's been exciting. So it's been a good
family. Yeah, keep inviting me to that stuff, because you invited me to something I couldn't go to.
That event sold out, actually, so it went well for us.
Good. Yeah. Anything else on the horizon that we can promote for you? Because I'd like people to come. Listen, this guy's super talented, and I bring guys like this because I want them to be seen by more folks.
James Martin, I don't know if you have him on before then, but he's actually playing the Bayou Boogaloo. I'm talking about I don't know if you're going to have him on before.
Oh, before the Boogaloo, right.
He'll be there with his band. That was the first festival I think Soul did was last year at the Bayou Boogaloo, and now we're like the kings of the festivals.
Dude, by the way, I mean, congrats on all this. I mean, obviously, they were instrumental for me starting this show. By the way, you're WWOZ. Are you still doing that gig, too?
Yeah, every Wednesday I do the New Orleans music show.
Yeah, what time is that?
That's 11 a.m. to 2 p.m.
90.7. Look, there's Aaron Lambert.
Look at him.
Aaron's getting a shout-out in the background. God, he looks like a character actor right there. Maybe Richard Bells or somebody.
Well, he's a character, that's for sure.
He's got the character part completely down. But real quick, I want to recap the things around the Jazz Fest week that you mentioned. Let's kind of go over that, because you went fast over the first thing. You're there the very first day. Yeah, so explain
right
that real quick.
Like at 12:40, right there at Lanyap Stage. So
the Lanyap Stage.
Just come over there and get you some dozen oysters, you know, and sit down and relax and take the little ride with us.
And you played with our guy Charlie Wooten recently, didn't you?
Oh, man, that was so much fun. There's a thing called Instant Opus where this guy just puts four musicians together and with no script and just go.
Yeah.
So like, man, Charlie was, it was a lot
He's
of fun.
He's fun, man. In fact, the championship game ended at like 11. That was the night of the NCAA championship game. And I get up at 6:30 for the show the next day. I was like, can't make that one. Yeah. I tried. But here, check this place out. It is Chaise de la Chaise
absolutely.
Maple.
I love those guys,
Carlton
by the way.
Between Carlton and Broadway. Thank you so much, man.
Thank you, Scott. Yeah,
absolutely. And we're going to have some more music from these great musicians, man. I can't wait. Hey, also, Steve Worthy from the Zurich. I want to thank him. Tanzel Smart, great. But we have two more coming up. Stay tuned right here on Primetime Sports. Hey, welcome back to Primetime Sports. And hey, listen, I know a lot of you basketball fans out there have been waiting for this particular segment because we're going to get right to it. We're going to talk about the Pelican season. We all know how it started, 0-8. The year before it was 1-11. It's hard to dig out of that hole, and it proved to be so. The Pels ended up winning 34 games this season. Not exactly what you wanted going into the season, but it's tough when you don't have your full gun to start the season. That, of course, me and Drew Holiday. But we're going to talk all about it to a guy who's one of my three favorite guys here in town. I'm not talking about the paper guys, but you know we have Jake Madison on, and you know all the other guys. But this is one you have to start following. His name is Ollie Cosell. One of the great names, by the way. I mean, this name is bound to grow. But he is with the Bird Rights, and you guys have been gaining a lot of attention and publicity. And that's how it works. You just kind of start a thing, and then people start noticing you have a good product. And here you are today. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for the warm introduction, Scott. Yeah, it's this is going to be about my fourth year heading into writing for the Bird Rights. And as you know, it started off relatively down at the bottom, non-relevancy after Chris Paul left. And now with DeMarcus Cousins coming in this season, we're floating. We're flying high.
Well, there was one publication that said, other than the Golden State Warriors, this is the team to watch in the future. Now, I think a lot of that would be contingent on a man named Boogie Cousins actually signing to stay with us. Are you concerned about him signing, getting this deal done this summer? He's got 1 year left on the contract. Or are you fine with letting it play out? And which I imagine, if I'm his agent, I'm telling him to let it play out because you don't know where. But what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, you're absolutely right, Scott. It would not be a smart business decision for him to sign on for this summer. Now, he's got to wait until he's a free agent and he's going to get the most amount of money, which he's obviously going to command. He's one of the top players in the NBA.
Yeah.
And even though he's not fully committed yet to coming back to New Orleans, I think the chances are pretty strong they're going to keep him here. Anthony Davis is a buddy. He seemed to have a really good time. He developed a camaraderie with all the players in the locker room in such a short span. And, you know, being 2 hours away from home, Mobile, Alabama, where supposedly his mom's cooking did the trick about a month ago, I think he's going to want to stay close to that.
Well, you know, obviously there was all the excitement when they got him, okay? And then I was listening to the radio. Some of the shows were like, yeah, I expect him to go 20-5 in the last 25 games. I'm like, I said, if they go over 500, I'll be happy. And they didn't make it quite there. They kind of let the end of the season go once they realized they weren't going to be in the playoffs. So they were a little bit below 500. But what I did see in a smattering of these games was progress. And that's what I wanted to see. Obviously, it was a tough start. You had a really hard game to open up against Houston. And it just wasn't going to happen. But the bottom line, did you see enough to make you excited about the future of this team?
Yeah, absolutely. I just recently wrote something the other day where I broke down the season into four segments. And this last segment with Boogie, once he got his first week out of the way out here in New Orleans, the team clicked. They played like a top 5-6 team in the NBA. The record didn't quite reflect it, but the numbers were all there. The offense was great.
Yes.
The defense was outstanding with Boogie. Everybody said Boogie can't play defense. Guess what? It was the best defense the Pelicans put on the field on the court all season. So, yeah, there's a time to be excited, and it is now.
I'm with Ollie Cosell. He is with the Bird Rights. And if you haven't checked that out, go to Twitter or just go to thebirdrights.com and check out some of his stuff. These guys get deep into it. I love it. Hey, as far as these two guys, I don't necessarily want to rank them, but how big are they as far as NBA standards on superstar level?
The biggest, because there's five positions in basketball. And Anthony Davis, to everybody's pretty much standards, is the top power forward in the league, even though people try and classify him as a center. But now he doesn't have to be pushing that center role. Now there's DeMarcus Cousins, who is probably the most versatile two-way player for an NBA center. He's ahead of the Marc Gasols and whoever else you want to throw out there simply because of his ability to take over a game on both ends of the floor. The thing is, can you know, stoke that fire of his to make sure he comes out for every game? Same thing's been said of AD too, but going forward, like we saw in these last 20 games or so where they played together, they did stoke their own fires. You know, there's a good chance that these guys are going to be able to take that next step forward as players.
You see the picture of Drew Holiday with them right there. That is the big question in the offseason. Will they re-sign Drew Holiday? Are they going to offer him max deal? What's it going to take to keep him, and do they want to keep him? I imagine that, you know, you're better with Drew Holiday than without Drew Holiday, but the money might be a factor. What are your thoughts on this? And here's the thing, man. You start the season 0-8, and that's because, you know, Drew was with his wife who was pregnant, and she had a brain tumor. And the Pelicans made no bones. They said, yep, go with your wife. Of course, that's the most important thing right now. And I think in Drew's mind that has to weigh a little bit that this team has taken care of him through his injuries. What are your thought process on him coming back, him wanting to come back, and the Pelicans wanting to pay a certain price?
I think he's going to be back, but I'm in the minority as to whether I want to see him come back. A lot of fans, right, they were, you know, upset by his play. He wasn't the Robin to AD's Batman this season.
Right.
He had a lot of tough games. But nobody seems to want to keep factoring in the fact that what you just mentioned, his wife, his family, home,
right,
it was a mess. I can't imagine being Drew wanting to play 82 games and jump right in the regular season with all this pressure on my shoulders, 0-8 start, and I'm supposed to carry a team playing, you know, a lot of these role players around me. So everything was on his shoulders. Now, he played, I thought, really well. He had sparks of where, you know, it just didn't click for him. But he made it through the season, and he showed his defense was top-notch all year. Now, as far as his contract, this is the biggie.
Yeah, it's a big deal.
Yeah, I don't think he's going to command max money, not from the Pelicans. Why? Because I think he wants to return here. The players have reached out to him constantly, the coaches, and like you said, they made allowances for him to whatever he needed. He needed some time off. They gave him space, you name it. So I think he's a family man. You know, he's not the guy that needs the limelight. He's going to respect that, and that's going to, you know, factor in his decision-making. Now, as far as numbers, I'm looking at probably starting off at $20 million for next season. So if you give him the pay raises over 5 years, that's going to be over $100 million. Now, that's steep, but that's, you know, the going rate for a small market team for a legitimate, you know, two-way point guard in this league.
So, all right. Is there another option out there in free agency if Drew didn't come back? Maybe a guy that – Drew looked like he might be, I mean, we know he can play either guard position, which is a nice luxury to have, but do you want your full-time point guard to be him, or would you rather one of these Chris Paul types that's a natural distributor? Obviously, they're not very many of them. He's a Hall of Famer. We know that. Or how about Chris Paul himself? Can we dream a little bit?
You had to mention Chris Paul. We can dream a little bit, because let's face it, I think the Clippers.
I said a Chris Paul type, to be honest, but I just threw him in, too.
Yeah, the chances are not good. Let's face it, salary cap issues, him coming back to New Orleans. He's already made it his well-known. He prefers a big market. But the Clippers, you know, they have not met any kind of expectations during his whole time in the Los Angeles area. So chances are he's going to be looking for a new location. And the chances are really almost infinitesimal. He can end up in New Orleans. But,
why infinitesimal? Just tell me why.
Well, first of all, the Pelicans are going to have about, if they didn't resign Drew Holiday, only about $18 million. Chris Paul's going to demand the max, and that's going to be roughly around, you know, the $30 million
range. But he wouldn't want to come just for a chance to win?
Well, unless you talk to him. I don't know. Give him a phone call.
Did stay
maybe
at the house
work.
Back when he was in high school. I did. Maybe a call would work. I doubt it very seriously. As far as building other pieces, do you like what they have right now? I mean, a lot of people have not said fond things about what the money you got. You paid Solomon Hill, obviously, Etuan Moore. Do you think these guys are a big part of the future? They're under contract.
Some of the roster is. Okay. Solomon Hill, I still, you know, he had his best three-point shooting percentage of his career. He came close to 35% this past year, as to where before I think it was like 32.5. So even though he missed a lot of shots and the fans groaned almost like every game, he actually improved. And I think he's going to keep, you know, steadily improving in that, you know, in that new role of his where he's the starting small forward for a team. Remember, this was the first time he was asked to play 82 games, a lot of minutes, and be like a primetime guy.
Yeah.
Etuan Moore, I love him. But outside of that, it's a lot of questions about why the centers.
What about
Omer Sheik, Alexi Ajensa.
Instant grits, baby.
Oh, he's got to come back.
I mean,
we got that
he was fun to watch.
He's a natural fit for Gentry's system. Gotta love that guy.
All right, I love having you on, man. Ollie Cosell, check him
Thank
out.
You,
There's
Scott.
A gift certificate for you. That's a place on Maple Street between Carrollton and Broadway, we like to say. And we have a tradition here. Put your big Ollie Cosell on there. He spells it a little different than you would expect. But, boy, it sounds good coming out of the mouth. Ollie Cosell, that's just perfect for being in the media. Hey, I want to thank him. Hey, we're not done. We had Derek Smoker Freeman a little while ago. We had some music. But we're coming up with Paul Atkinson. He is a producer, director, and he has done a bunch of great documentaries, and we're going to have one coming up right here on Primetime Sports. Stay tuned!
Oh my God! No, back up, back up, guys! Oh my God, guys, that is woo! That is the worst.
Every play that gets
that is
really.
And he's gonna call for
45.
Yeah, that's an awful call. Thank you. They hold every down, and you're calling downfield. He does a garbage crew.
They gave us three down. Then they went to a four-man look. They covered up. Looked like on the jet, Chris could have gotten that. We could have thrown it to him, right? We're going to go bullet right, jet right, buck odd pop. So we're jetting to the field. Bullet right, jet right, buck odd pop. Let's go. Old teammate of mine, and it's important to me. Some of the parents may know. A guy that played me, Wilkins Kearney. Okay, I went to his funeral today. And he's a guy I really looked up to and loved. And all of the guys that were in the service today, as I said, came up. They asked about this football team. And I believe... And the hope the Lord, he's looking down on you. And as I always say, it's a reminder to you that this team is so much more than the guys in the huddle. There's so many people that are following you and love you and just go want to, you know, root for you. But you represented that name tonight. You represented Wilkins very well. And that was important just to me, okay? And you represent this community very well.
Well, that is Newman head coach Nelson Stewart. He was on the undefeated Newman team, Tulane team in 1998, coached by Tommy Bowden. He was an offensive lineman on that team. He has done some great things at Newman, and he has been the one of the parts of a big documentary series that Paul Atkinson, my next guest, has been doing called Glory Days. I went to the first one at the Britannia Theater. It had Jay Tyler, of course, Herb Tyler's son, the quarterback, and also the great running back, Kendall Bussey, who is, well, he is the son of the bus who played at Colorado. But Paul Atkinson's done some great things. I'm telling you this. He did the John Curtis documentary. He did the Manning to Manning one. He did the thing at South Plaquemine when the schools came together after Katrina and several more. We're going to get into that. But here he is, and this is going to air, this new Glory Days edition on CST. I believe it's Friday night. Welcome to the show, Paul.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me. It's a great honor to be on Scott Alexander's show promoting my Glory Days program.
Well, I can't wait to talk about it because I was blown away, literally blown away at the first one. I cannot wait to see this one. You had the sneak preview at the theater, and I thought it was fabulous. Tell people who saw the first Glory Days, which featured those great stars who are playing now at Stanford and Texas A&M, et cetera. Mm-hmm. And what should they expect from this new version of it?
Well, this time we go into more of the background of some of the kids, some of the coaches, some of their little stories that went through this football season. So it's not just football. It's not just about wins and losses. You see the poster up there.
That's a beautiful poster, yeah.
Yeah, poster for the actual TV show. But we go through some of the backstories, and I'll give you some examples.
Yeah.
If you have Miles LePere,
right, this was quarterback, going to be going to Tulane as well.
This was his senior year. Great, great time to make your mark at Newman with all the great players that they've had over the last few decades.
Sure, sure.
He actually finished third behind Peyton, Eli, and Miles in yards passing.
So you're talking about guys named Peyton Manning and Peyton Eli Manning, who have, what, four Super Bowl championships among them?
But
Pretty good company.
And so he's going to be with Tulane as a preferred walk-on.
Right.
But he had a great senior year.
Yeah, he did.
36 touchdowns, only six interceptions.
Wow.
Took the team on his back. They did have some adversity during the middle of the season. They had a four-game losing streak, but they basically played in the SEC of 2A football. They had, you know, Riverside. You have St. Charles Catholic. And, of course, Riverside won the entire state championship. You have St. Charles Catholic. Country Day had a really good team this year. So they had a lot of competition that they had to play. And they had a little losing streak, but they were able to make the playoffs, and we kind of tell the story. So go ahead.
Well, no, you mentioned earlier a guy named Ryan White. When people hear Ryan White's name, they think of the Elton John song and the young man who died of AIDS years ago. But this Ryan White is a football player that has a pretty remarkable story.
Ryan White is a junior defensive lineman, offensive lineman, and actually his story is he started the season August two-a-days with Denham Springs High School, which is a 5A program. And then they had the massive flooding. So he was affected. He had to transfer. He was able to transfer to Louisiana High School Athletic Association and got to Newman. And he gave them incredible depth this season.
So Denham Springs to Newman.
Yes.
It's a remarkable story. I mean, what was he like as a person?
He's a great young man. The parents have raised him very well, very well-spoken. And you could just tell leadership qualities – a tremendous leadership ethic.
And how'd they take him in? Was it all
they
cool?
took him in?
Right, nice.
And we have one of the players, Isaac Andre, talk about that. That you know, when you're here at Newman, you're home.
Right. And Gilly was his brother, yep. And Gibby is his father,
yep.
Who I grew up with,
yes.
And I know them well. By the way, Isaac's a pretty good ball player. Yeah. Surprised me with his feet. But I want to talk a little bit about some of the other stuff you've done real quick. I mean, because it's impressive. You have a big thing. And I kind of rattled off some of it, but let people know some of these other docs.
Manning to Manning was our first big one.
We'll explain that real quick.
Okay, Manning to Manning was the story of the 1991 Newman season where you had Peyton and Cooper. That was the only year they ever played high school football together.
Yep.
And Peyton was the sophomore quarterback, and Cooper was the all-state wide receiver. They got all the way to the high school semifinals and lost, by, I think it was 2 points.
Which is the farthest they've gone.
And
Right.
And they lost to the eventual state champion, and that's as far as they went. But it was the story of that season.
And you've done some Curtis stuff.
We did John Curtis for 2 years.
Powerhouse, obviously.
Yeah, we had Malachi Dupree and
Duke Riley
on those two shows.
Who both would be in the top 3 rounds we expect in the NFL draft.
So, and we also did Ryan Perilou, his senior year at East St. John, where he was the one in a million player. He became the National High School Player of the year that we covered him. So, incredible stories of just high school football in general is what we like to do.
Well, let's promote this one this week because this is big. I want you guys to watch this. It's going to re-air a lot on CST if you happen not to be there. But it's this Friday night
on CST. 7 to 8 p.m. is the actual premiere. It'll run all through the weekend.
Right.
You can go to coxsportstv.com. Go check out their schedule listings, and you'll see the different replays. We also have two viewings of it on Fox 8 WVUE for people who have Dish or DirecTV.
Oh, wow. Okay, that's good to know.
Yes.
Because a lot of folks do have that. That's why, you know, I'm glad we are on both CST and WLE for those people on Dish. I'm going to give you this gift certificate, and we're going to sign the Saints ball, but also I'm going to give you an opportunity to thank some of your sponsors.
Yes.
You know, that helped you get this thing done.
Very quickly, I want to thank the Robert and Patty LePere family.
Yeah.
Miles'
parents, I'm sure.
Yes. Gibby Andre Law Firm.
Yeah.
My business partner, VersaBar, heavy lift specialist in Belle Chasse, and Johnson Rice and Company as well.
We hooked you up, brother.
Thank you very much.
Paul Wilkinson.
It's always great to see you.
I have a friend named Paul Wilkinson. That's why I'm sorry I call you that twice. but Paul Atkinson does phenomenal work. I mean, I'm blown away. For somebody that's done stuff like that, you can appreciate when you see it done well, and he does it great. Check it out this Friday night, trust me. Hey, coming up next, we're closing the show. Hey, I forgot. This is the end of the show. Thank you, everybody, from CST and WLE, in particular, producer Will Hill, Jay Smoove, Kenny Juno, everybody else that's associated with it. Thank you so much. We'll see you next time.